Welcome back, and if this is your first time, I'll let you know that I am a gold, silver, and bronze medalist with the United States Dressage Federation, and I also have all three of my freestyle bars, same thing, gold, silver, and bronze. I have developed yoga ball dressage to help my students practice at home their skills for their lessons. And a lot of times when I get a new client, I say, here's yoga ball dressage one. Go home and see if you can work on that. And even if you just watch it and don't even do it on the yoga ball, still you will start to understand what I'm going to tell you to do in a lesson. And so this is the genesis of this project. And now it's just developed from there. And a lot of you have been enjoying and benefiting from this series, and I hope to continue that. And so today I was thinking about second level, and I have done a training level test three guided tour, so to speak, on the yoga ball, and also a picture in picture. So that is yoga ball dressage two. And I was going to do a first level test three as well, because that's the test that you have to show for championships when you go to the championships. And since the show season is just starting to ramp up and get going into spring, I thought this was an appropriate time to talk about first level and second level and how to ride those movements. So specifically talking about shoulder in, haunches in, counter canter, how to make sure your horse is on the outside rein enough to be able to be accurate and not lose the horse's flexion to the inside and bend when you do those movements from one to the next. So that's kind of what we're going to talk about. So today I'll be sitting on the yoga ball, and right now I have a line in my yoga ball. Most yoga balls have a line in them already, or else I have several that have a little Sharpie line. Unfortunately, my dogs and my miniature horse like to play with yoga balls too, so you know, this one doesn't have a line. This one has its own seam, and so I try to make sure that my zipper seam lines up with that. And then that way I know that if I sit on my left seat bone right now, the ball, you can see, it kind of falls to the right. And that is, I'm thinking that that is my horse's rib cage. So when I sit on my left seat bone, I want the horse's rib cage to sway like a hammock into my outside leg. So you can see how the ball moves into my outside leg that way. So same thing happens to the right. If I sit on my right seat bone, then the yoga ball or the horse's rib cage fills in my outside leg, and therefore I feel the bend, and the horse feels my seat bone weight aid and moves away from that pressure or that weight. So you don't have to really push down, like you don't want to be like this, right? But you just want to drop that hip. And if you were standing up, you could think about when you put your hands on your hips, you're going to drop that knee, and that drops your hip. Drop the left knee, that drops your hip. So it's the same kind of an action. You just slide that hip down into the saddle by bending that knee a little bit more, okay? Now, for lateral movements specifically, you want to be able to weight your inside seat bone or lighten it for a haunches in or a half pass. And so what I think about is when I am going to, I'll turn to the side here for a second, when I'm going to ask for a leg yield or a shoulder in, I want to think about bringing my inside seat bone back and down into my inside heel. So that way I'm bringing that seat bone down into my heel, weighting my heel down. And then when I ask for a haunches in, I actually want to do the opposite a little bit. I want to keep my weight on this seat bone, but I want to bring the seat towards the inside knee. And therefore my heel might just come up off the floor a little bit, but that's okay. You don't need to have your heels down all the time in dressage like you do in jumping. Just there on the stirrup is usually enough, unless you have a fractious horse. But in general, you don't need to worry too much about heels slammed down. And so Anyway, so inside hip down and back into the inside heel. So you weight that heel and that leg and lengthen that leg. Or for shoulder in, I'm sorry, for shoulder in or leg heel. Or inside hip forward to inside knee. And you can step into that stirrup just a touch more with your ball of your foot. And then that will allow the horse to bring its hip in where your hip has left sort of the area. And your hip invites them to bring their inside hip in. Meanwhile, you're bringing your outside leg back to increase that. And your outside rein is opening to keep the shoulder on the rail. So we'll get into that more in a minute. But mainly, I wanted to talk about how flexion is such an important part of your lateral work. So if you have flexion, you can inside flexion. So when I say inside flexion, I talk about playing with the inside rein. I open and close my fingers. I might even bring my elbow back a little bit and ask for the horse to turn its head and soften its jaw. So I'm going to ask for this softening of the horse's jaw. Now I don't want to go jerk, 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 because then that would make them go, ugh, right, against it. So we want to get them to soften that jaw and give you a nice feeling into the outside rein. Now, if your outside rein, if you ask with your inside rein for this, your outside rein gets further and further forward, then all that really happens is that the horse can turn its head but not be on the bit. So you want to keep the outside hand near the saddle while you flex them. That way they get rounder and flexed as you do that technique. So flexion, I started calling it the F word very recently, and in a good way. And so we need flexion to create outside rein connection. And so everybody talks about inside leg to outside rein. And my theory is that I can't use my inside leg, or the horse can't hear my inside leg, until I have the horse softer and stepping towards my outside rein with their body. Therefore, the rib cage and the shoulders are pressing into my outside leg and rein. And then when I use my inside leg, then the horse can respond, because I'm not in their mouth, in their mouth, in their mouth, in their mouth. You see? So you can always ask for flexion into outside rein connection along with your inside sitpum. Then when you feel that pressure on that outside rein just a touch, then you can say, okay, now move away from my inside leg and actually step over into that outside rein. And that's what you want to do with your inside leg, is you want to say step, 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 because you don't want the horse to quicken and speed up when you ask for a leg yield or a shoulder in. You want them to maintain the same rhythm, right? So in order to maintain the same rhythm, your leg aid needs to be rhythmic. And if you press it on them, they're either going to do one of two things. They're going to go faster, which we don't want, or they're just going to get dull to that leg and they're going to say, oh, that leg is always there. I don't know why she has it there all the time, but I don't need to pay attention to it. Okay, so one of two things. So shoulder in and leg yield are the same in that you bring your inside hip back and down to your inside knee, and you turn your shoulders to the inside a little bit. And for both, you might, mostly leg yielding, you need to open your outside rein in order to allow that shoulder to step into it so they cross over into that outside hand, okay, towards the right if you're bending left. In the shoulder in, they need to be turning to the inside. So your outside rein is generally against their neck, almost like a Western neck rein kind of idea, because you want to turn your shoulders, which tells the horse to turn its shoulders, along with your inside hip down and your inside heel down. And then you press them into that outside rein and to cross the shoulders sideways to make that nice big step. Okay, the inside hind leg engages and steps forward towards your outside hand. Now, if your outside hand gives, you might get a neck in. Your instructor might tell you you're doing a neck in. If your outside rein opens, then you're just not going to show very much angle. Okay? Now, The big trick to me to learning how to do a good counter canter is to combine the two aids between shoulder in and hunches zip. And so I do a lot of this as I go around the arena. I go shoulder in to the inside, so shoulder in left, sinking down my inside seat bone to my inside heel, and then pressing my horse rhythmically into my outside rein. And then I will straighten the horse out by opening my outside rein, bringing my inside hip forward, but still down into this inside seat bone. And then I'll bring my outside leg back here. So my outside rein opening brings the shoulders straighter to the rail, back to the rail out of a hunches or shoulder in, sorry. So I'm taking the horse from shoulder in to hunches in by opening this outside rein. Now the whole while we're keeping the flexion to the left. So you might have to play with that left rein just a little bit to keep them soft and connected to the outside rein, because that's of primary importance. Now, with your body, you sink your inside heel or inside seat bone into your inside knee a little bit forward, and then you bring your outside leg back, and then you should have a hunches in. Now, to increase it, you can open the outside rein a bit more, but always bringing it backward a little bit, because the horse's body should be turning a little bit so that the right side of the horse's mouth is coming back towards you in the same moment as its inside or outside hip is going into the inside of the arena. Hopefully that makes sense. So the horse should actually sort of pivot its body to the inside, so the hunches are now to the inside rail, or of the rail, of the arena, I should say. So let's do that one more time. Inside seat bone down, turning your shoulders for the shoulder in, inside leg rhythmically asking for the hind leg, inside hind leg to step into this outside rein. Then when you go to hunches in, you're gonna first open your outside rein, maintain the flexion by playing a little bit with this inside rein if you need it. And then you're going to bring your inside hip forward and your outside leg back. And when you bring your inside hip forward, you should be able to bring this inside hip back much easier, of course, because you're already putting it back by pushing this one forward. And then if you keep this one down, then you should be able to lift this one up just a touch. I'm exaggerating so you can see it, okay? Now, how does this correlate to counter canter? Same exact idea. As you're coming around, let's say second level test three, you do the counter canter on the three loop serpentine. So you start on, we're gonna go left again. So you start on the left lead, the true lead, come around for your serpentine. And I always think a little bit of shoulder four on that first circle, half circle there into the serpentine. Then as I come towards the center line, then I start to think a little bit of hunches in to the lead that I'm on. So remember, we're on the left lead. So you're gonna bring your right rein open a little bit to bring the horse's right shoulder over here to turn onto that new line for the second loop that's gonna come around. And then you're going to bring this outside leg back just a touch further than what you had before. And in the same moment, you're gonna bring that inside hip forward to encourage the horse's inside hip to come this way. So that you're now doing hunches in, or you can think of it as a renvers because it's to the outside right now. Even though you're still on the left lead, you can think of it as a renvers if that helps you. And then you can go back into a shoulder in position and finish your serpentine. So I'm gonna start that again. We're gonna talk about a three loop serpentine with counter canter in second level test three. So we're gonna start our loop on the true lead, left lead. So inside seat bone down into inside heel. And then we're gonna keep the outside leg back a little bit and we're turning onto that serpentine. So the outside rein is coming over here and turning your horse onto that serpentine. So we're gonna do that first loop with left flexion, and we're gonna maintain that left flexion as we think about transitioning from a shoulder in positioning to make that first true lead loop. And then we're going to think a little bit of hunches in like we did in the trot for that second counter canter loop. So we're still flexing left, we're still cantering on the left lead, but we're making a right half circle 20 meters. And then when we hit the center line or approach the center line to finish and go into the third and last loop on the true lead, then we're gonna think again a little bit inside hip down to inside heel and turn and finish that serpentine, okay? So that is how the trot work, working from shoulder into hunches in, can translate and help you with the true canter to counter canter. So in second level test 3, that's what we did. In second level test 2, you do a half 20 meter circle in counter canter. And those are, you know, identical the way you ride them. So I hope this helps you today and thinking of your movements in second level and how to arrange your body to do them. So we can do those to the right as well. So when you are doing a shoulder in and the trot to the right, you're gonna sit on your right seat bone, drop that hip. Like I showed you earlier, inside hip down to inside heel. So you kind of rock back just a little bit into your seat bone, into the back of the saddle, just a touch. And then when you transition to a hunches in, you wanna maintain the flexion while working this inside hand a little bit while you open your outside rein. Now, when you open your outside rein, you're also going to bring your inside hip forward to your inside knee, and then your outside leg can kind of slide back to ask for more hunches in. And then the opening of the outside rein brings the shoulder back to the rail. From the shoulder in, you're here, to the hunches in, bringing that shoulder out. And then if you bring it back a little bit more, then that's just going to increase the angle, the horse's angle in that hunches in. Now, if we were gonna go and use that same technique for counter canter, we're gonna go onto the three loop serpentine to the right now. And our first loop is a true lead. So if you think of the true lead canter as a little bit of a shoulder in positioning, so inside seat bone down to inside heel, and then you turn your shoulders just a touch so that your horse's shoulders are coming to the inside every stride, then you are making that turn onto that first loop every stride. Then, as you approach the center line, you start to think a little bit about your hunches in technique and you open your outside rein just a touch and you think about sliding your inside hip forward to your inside knee, and then you bring that outside shoulder and hip back just a touch more to help the horse understand that you want it to continue on the right bend, on the right lead, and go into a circle, half circle to the left. That's the tricky part. So they have to sit down every stride with their hind legs and lift their shoulders and bring them over to the middle. So if you think about counter canter, the reason why it's hard for the horse is because they go forward and down, and then they have to rock back their body in order to take these front legs and pick them up and turn them this way. So that's where that open outside rein comes in, is it says, now turn this way. The horse goes down. Turn this way. The horse goes down. Your hands don't necessarily have to go this far with them. I'm exaggerating it, but that is why it's hard for your horse to do. So give them a little bit of a break. If they do a flying change or they trot or whatever, then you just say, okay, that's all right. We're going to bring it all back to the walk and we're going to practice our transition to counter canter on the straightaway, if that's the best place for you, or on the circle. Also, if you can accomplish that relatively, you know, easily, because the horse has a harder time picking a counter canter on a circle usually than on the straightaway. So sometimes I'll just say, okay, that's all right. We're just going to go straight, regroup, get that counter canter. Then we'll start turning, and then finish that serpentine into the true lead to the right, thinking a little bit of shoulder in. I hope this helps you with your leg yielding in the trot, shoulder in and hunches in, and using the same techniques for the shoulder in to hunches in the trot to create a counter canter, true lead to counter canter, same idea, okay?